Hey, this is Phil Varone from Red Dragon Cartel, and that just happened. Hey guys, what's going on? It is Front Row Joe, and we made it to Greenville, South Carolina. We're at the Firmament. Showed up at the parking lot.
Yeah.
Found this big bus, and guess who was inside? This guy right over here, Phil Varone. Phil.
Big hair right now. Look at this. I have my own fan right now that's just blowing on me.
Yeah, you can't see it. It's off camera. He requested it in his rider that he needed a fan for sexiness.
It's a fan assistant. It's actually somebody on a gerbil wheel. It's a very odd thing. We don't really go to high tech here. So it's a gerbil wheel, and they're running, and the fan's going. And I just want to know how far I can drive this bit into the ground. But good to see you.
How you doing?
I'm doing good. It's good to see you out on the road with Red Dragon Cartel. Absolutely. Supporting the new album, Patina. And they had a little bit of a revolving door on a couple of the positions. Yeah. And, you know, kind of feeling some things out and kind of figuring out what they wanted to do. But now you guys collaborated, wrote, recorded. Now you're on tour, solid band. How is that? Does that figure into the live shows when you've got a set foursome that you're taking the circus out on the road?
Yeah, you know, I wasn't here when they were doing all the touring with the singers and stuff like that. I just heard about it.
Yeah.
And I can't imagine how that must have been, you know, like a new singer. So I think because of the first record was a little different than this, and Jake really wanted a band, you know, that was going into the record. Once I knew they needed a drummer, and I immediately went down there and tried for the gig, it was very much a band type atmosphere. And that's it shows now, because even, you know, it's Jake's band, you feel like a band member, you know, and we're having a good time on stage, and I love these guys. And we're when you see the show, you'll understand, no matter what goes on in the bus, and we've had breakdowns and craziness during the tour, that 90 minutes on stage is like what we live for, and we're having a blast. I mean, we're just having such a good time, and it's very loose, and it's very fun. And I think fans are kind of like shocked that it's that fun and loose, you know, like there's no, like, you know, intro music, you know, and these breaks where I remember in my bands would be like, okay, three songs and then you talk. This is just like Jake comes on, we don't even know when we're going on. Like, there's a set time, and Jake will come over and go, all right, you ready? And yeah, we'll go on and just walk on and start playing. And I think it's fun this way, you know?
Yeah.
We're not trying to prove anything. We're just a bunch of, you know, older guys that are having some fun playing some rock and roll.
We've kind of already been there, done that, and proven that you guys are venerable musicians. So, you know, there's really nothing left to prove but just have a good time, right?
Yeah, that's pretty much it. I mean, the pep talk that Jake gave us on the first night was hysterical. Because, you know, everybody's a little, you know, jumpy, and we just got off of a 2,800 mile drive, you know, on the bus. Everybody's burnt out, it's cold. And Jake was in the dressing room, very Lombardi-esque, says
with a clipboard and everything?
Just about. I think he was holding a Jameson bottle, but nonetheless, that's his clipboard. He goes, all right, it's the first show. He goes, I don't expect it to be perfect. I don't expect anybody to play perfect. He goes, in fact, if you play perfect, I'm going to be pissed off, because I'm not going to play perfect, and your job is to make me look good. So, and he just said, it's just rock and roll. Let's go out and have some fun. So, you know, Jake's a very laid-back guy, very fun, and I'm just having a blast playing with him.
Yeah, cool. And you mentioned when you got the call, hey, try out. I don't know if you know this, but I had a conversation with Anthony, bass player, mm-hmm. who said that I guess when Jake was looking for someone that could handle the skins in the back there for the cartel, that your name came up, and after watching how you worked the toms, that was pretty much what sealed the deal. Did you know that?
No, I didn't. Well, I knew that when I heard about it. Scott Wilson, who plays bass in Saving Abel, called me. It was this very secret type call, and he's like, "Hey, do you know how to play like Bill Ward?" I'm like, I guess. I mean, I could play like Sabbath. He's like, all right, hold on a second. He, you know, and I'd wait, and he'd go, hey, can you play like Carmine Appice? I'm like, okay, what's going on? And then, like, one more. I finally, I'm like, dude, what is the gig?
Yeah.
Enough already with the mystery. And then he told me it was Jake. So I immediately talked to Ant, and he sent me a couple of songs. And I went into rehearsal, and I sent them some video of me playing. It was actually Speedbag.
Oh, okay.
And I was doing my version of Speedbag, which is like Tom stuff. But as soon as I heard from Ant, I immediately bought a plane ticket. And I go, I'm coming on Saturday. They're like, what? I go, yeah, I'm coming. So it was like that fast. And I think it was a combination of the fact that I, you know, wanted to get there, and I wasn't screwing around. I bought my own tickets. I wasn't, you know, I just wanted to get there and try it out. That's what really kind of sealed the deal. Although they let me wait a week, you know, like on pins and needles until they finally, you know, Jake finally, you know, told me. But yeah, it was pretty cool. And this record has been and is the best drumming I've ever done. And playing with these guys, the best players I've ever played with, and the most I've learned in the studio. So it's been a really cool ride in that regard.
Yeah.
The whole process, even though it took 2 years, it's like, well, if you can wait 2 years, this is the record you put out, you know?
Yeah. Well, you mentioned it too. You know, you guys are all accomplished musicians, have been around the block for sure with different outfits, and so now it's really about playing the music and having a good time, and again, being with a collection of established musicians that are great musicians.
Yeah.
Is it upping everyone else's game?
Oh yeah. No, for sure. And even in my mind, you know, we play in front of a musician crowd too. So they expect us to be good.
Yeah.
You know, Jake has that resume, that pedigree where, you know, if you're playing with Jake, you got to be great.
Yeah.
And I remember right before the tour started, I was at a rehearsal at my rehearsal place in Vegas, and I was carrying, I put a big set list together, and it had Badlands on it, all the songs we were playing. And this guy was just outside smoking a cigarette that I didn't know. And he goes, oh, Badlands, we in a cover band? And I go, oh, something like that. And he goes, and then the guy sitting next to him, like, that knows me is like, he goes, no, he plays with Jakey Lee. And the guy goes, oh, you must be great, like that. And it just got me nervous because I never really thought about it
like that.
But that's what people expect. And the band is playing great. I mean, we've had some train wrecks in the beginning, but now it's like no one's thinking. We're just having a good old time. And, you know, Jake is taking longer solos and you know, Ant's playing longer, and you know, my drum solos are getting longer, and it all really depends on Jake on the drum solo. He penalized me the other night because I was doing laundry and missed sound check, so I got penalized, which meant, so I get done with my drum solo and he goes, no, you owe me another 5 minutes right there, and I had to go start up again. And it was really funny. So it's that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, like, we're just having a good time. So.
Yeah. No, that's good. And you know, we referenced that you guys have been around the block. Certainly fans know you from Saigon Kick and Skid Row. What are you going to take away, and you alluded to it a little bit, but what are you going to take away from this experience with Red Dragon?
Yeah, I mean, just positive stuff. You know, I mean, we've just had nothing but positive. It's been an honor to play with these guys. Get to know Jake. He's a great human. He lives in Vegas, so we're friends. You know, like we get to go out and hang out as well. So I got friends out of this. I got an incredible musical experience, and quite frankly, made me better as a player.
Yeah.
Without a doubt, you know, so I truly am grateful that I was able to do this.
Right. That's really cool.
Yeah.
We like to close it with a That Just Happened moment. If one out of your storied career kind of pops to the forefront of your head.
Well, I was just a good friend of mine is here right now at this show. He was my bass player in a band called Ripping Fingers when we were kids. We were probably like 14, 15,
wow,
and we did. He played the talent show with me, which made me from a weirdo in high school to a cool guy because I played the talent show. But we were just talking about Jake. And when Jake played South Florida, he was with Ozzy, obviously, and Motley was opening the show. And I was a huge Motley Crue fan. And I went with a guy who said he was Jake's cousin.
Okay.
And he goes, hey, you know, we'll get there. My cousin will give us backstage passes. And when you're a kid, you know, you don't know. You're like, all right, cool. So this kid is like trying to get to Jake and telling them that he's Jake's cousin. And 30 years later, I'm in a band with Jake. So you know, like I watched him on stage. So when you talk about that, like that kind of cool thing, but the first thing I asked Jake, I go, do you have a cousin named Richard? He's like, no, I have no idea who that guy is. So the guy was full of crap the whole time. But it was just, you know, you were going with the fantasy that I was going to be able to meet Jake.
And
now I'm in a band with him, you know, 30 years later. So it's actually, you know, it's full circle.
Yeah.
So that's where the fun stuff, you know, where you think. And I'll tell you know, you get used to playing with him, and then he'll play, you know, Bark at the Moon, and you go, oh, that's the guy. That's what it's supposed to sound like. And those are those aha moments, or those that just happened moments, if you will. So it's actually pretty funny. The music business is fun in that respect. So,
well, we certainly appreciate the time. Can't wait for the show tonight. Phil Varone, thank you so very much. Guys, that just happened.